Praise the Lord, saints, and welcome back to FFT, Food for Thought Ministries, where we move with purpose in our walk with Christ over here. My name is Rokisha Muhammad, and welcome to my channel. If you're new here, welcome, welcome, welcome. If you've been with me since day one, welcome back, family. All right, family, this is our Sunday weekly devotional, and of course, we are using the God is Faithful, my devotional. And we are currently on week 13. So let's go ahead and turn to that. All right, our topic for today is a heart like God's. A heart like God's. And our foundational text today is going to be found in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. And we're just going to read that really quickly. And it says, "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." Uh-oh, this is going to be good. This is going to be good. I already see it's going to be good. Holy Spirit, you better do your thing today. So what we do in this devotion, we're going to go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and read the full chapter, okay? Then we're going to read the study notes in the Bible of choice this week, which I will reveal in a moment. Then after we read the full chapter, we're going to read the study notes. Then we're going to come back and read the full devotional through one time. Then we'll come back a second time and read it with my commentary and pull out any nuggets, do our underlining and highlighting, okay? So let's go ahead and pray in first. Then I'm going to reveal the Bible for the week. Let's get into it. Whew. Father God, we glorify you, we magnify you, we lift up your holy name, we exalt you on today, Lord God. We ask for forgiveness, Lord, for all of our sins, known and unknown. We ask for our hearts to be sanctified, purified, and cleansed, Lord God. Anything that is separating us from you, may you remove it now, Lord God, creating us a clean and renewed spirit. Fill us with the Holy Spirit right now in the name of Jesus. We also ask right now, Father God, for our spiritual eyes to be open so that we may see. For our spiritual ears to be open so that we can hear. We ask for our hearts to be open to receive this word, Lord God, and not just be hearers only, but doers also. We ask right now, Father God, for you to descend upon us your divine spirit of wisdom, your spirit of knowledge, your spirit of clarity, your spirit of understanding, your spirit of revelation, and your spirit of discernment. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Have your way and teach us today in the mighty and matchless name of Yeshua HaMashiach. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Are you ready, family? Woo, glory be to God. I'm already fired up just on the topic. A heart like God. Okay, so we prayed in. So let's reveal the Bible of the week. And those of you who are new, I've decided to use a new study Bible every single week to do our studies in, just so you guys can see my Bibles and I can pick them up and use them. Okay, so that's why it's a new Bible every week, if you're wondering why I'm switching Bibles. That was just something I'm trying new this year. So far, it's been working okay. So the Bible for the week is, drum roll, gotta do the drum roll. Our Bible is, come on, family, the NIV Study Bible, okay? This is by Zondervan. This is a big girl. She's a big, hefty, she's a big girl. When I tell you she big, she's big. So this is, again, is the NIV Study Bible, okay? So this is the Bible that we're gonna be using today. So let's go ahead and turn to, this is a thumb index, as you can see. No tabs on this one. This is a large print. We need to get to, what is it, 2 Peter. All right, 2 Peter chapter 3. Let me get it together, y'all. Y'all know I don't plan nothing. I just come on here and hit play, and we get what we get. So we're going to read 2 Peter. Oh, let me pull you down so you can see. We're going to be going to 2 Peter chapter 3. So go ahead and grab your Bibles. All right. so we can read the full chapter 3. And then we're going to read our study notes. Then we'll come back and do this devotional. So let's take a note that our foundational text is 3 and 9. So let me just close this up. And let's go ahead and do our reading. Oh, we got a lot of notes. Look at all these notes. So yeah, 3 starts over here. So we got all this to read for notes. Oh, this is a short chapter. Oh, okay. This is going to be fast. Well, let me not say that because y'all know I'm. Let me not say that. Okay, so let's just get started with our reading. I hope you are here for it. Hope you got your Bibles out. Again, this is the NIV Study Bible. All right? All right, so let's go ahead with our word. Let me make sure I got my highlighters. Put these over here. All right, fam, so let's get into it. This is NIV. I mean, 2 Peter chapter 3. Ooh, that's a bar. Here we go. So let's go. It says, the day of the Lord. It says, dear friends, this is now my second letter to you. I have written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. Again, we go verse by verse, line by line, precept upon precept. So we just go analyze each verse, okay? So we're going to read it again. Yes, we are. Dear friends, talking to the believers, okay? This is now my second letter to you. So this is the second letter I believe Paul have written. And he says, I have written both of them as reminders to stimulate you to wholesome thinking. So he is writing the letters to stimulate the believers to wholesome thinking. All right? So let me just highlight that. This letter is written to stimulate wholesome thinking. All right, so let's keep going. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the commands given by our Lord and Savior through your apostles. I'm trying to see where these... Oh, those is for cross references. I was like, what is all these little letters? You see this K here? You got a J here. I guess it's telling you to go over here to look at the cross references, but we're not doing that today. If you have cross references, I highly recommend you go and read them, but we're not doing it today, okay? So let's read it one more time. So we know that Paul is writing this letter to stimulate wholesome thinking. So let's keep that in mind. Second verse says, I want you to recall. So this is something that we should be doing as believers, to recall what? The words spoken. Okay, so there have been some words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by your Lord and Savior through your apostles. Okay, so basically he wants us to remember the commands that has been taught through the apostles, and we know it was the 12 disciples, right? One more time, let's read it again. Ooh, I know. Just let me chew on this for a second. I want you to recall the words spoken in the past by the holy prophets and the command given by our Lord and Savior through your prophets. Okay, so that's clear. So he's writing to stimulate our wholesome thinking. Stimulate us to wholesome thinking. And what does he want us to remember? He wants us to remember the spoken word or the teachings of the prophet and the commands that were given to us by the Lord and Savior through the prophets. So hopefully you understand that. I can't break that down no clearer. It's pretty clear already though. Okay, so let's continue. Above all, So this is very important, okay? Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. Come on, if we ain't seeing that today. Above all, you must understand, church, brothers and sisters in Christ, you must, let me circle that, understand that in the last days, this is how you know we're in the last days. Scoffers will come. The Bible is telling us scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. Come on now. The Bible didn't leave nothing out. So this is how we're going to recognize also that we're in the last days. He said, above all, Paul said, above all, believers, you must understand that scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires, not the Lord's. They're not following the teachings of the Lord. They're following their own evil desires. And if you don't know what a scoffer is, let me just look it up real quick. I wasn't trying to do all this, but since this is a kind of a short read, and the Holy Spirit said, look it up, even though I kind of know what it is, let me just look it up, because the Lord said, do it. I got to be obedient. He said, look it up. I was trying not to look it up. I was like, y'all know what that mean? And he said, look it up three times. I heard him say, look it up three times. So let me be obedient. Scoffer. Okay. He ain't coming for me today. No, he is not. Okay. Scoffer is the name of the arrogant, haughty man who acts with arrogant pride. Okay, that's what it says for a biblical translation. Let me just see what a regular translation is. Scoffer. Oh, it says scoffer in the Bible. Let me just say scoffer definition. Give me a second, y'all. Okay. I'm trying to find my, you know, the one that says it out loud. Scoffer. Where's my definition? My computer's going so slow. Okay. Scoffer. This is not what I want. Come on now, Google. Give me a second, y'all. Sorry. Scoffer definition. It's still not looking like what I want. Let's see.
Scoffer. Scoffer.
Okay, well, go ahead on then. Scoffer, scoffer.
Scoffer.
It says someone who jeers or mocks or treats something with contempt or calls out in derision. Okay, that's what a scoffer is. Even though this still ain't the one I usually be having up. Where's my regular stuff? Anyway, a scoffer is a person that treats something with contempt. Let's see. I don't want that one. I know, y'all. Just, oh, here. This is my, do I do dictionary.com? Let me see if this is the one I usually use. My computer's so slow today. Okay, a scoffer on this one. Let me see how it sound. Oh. It says a person who mocks or makes fun of someone or something, often of religion or moral value. So that's what a scoffer is. A person that's going to tease you and make fun of you. Okay?
Scoffer. Or oh. Scoffer.
What? I didn't even push no button, y'all. That's scary. I didn't push no button for you to start talking to me. Ooh. Okay, wait a minute. Let me get off of this one. I don't know what this is doing. It's doing something all by itself. Okay, let's move on. I'm sorry. I didn't push no button. Okay, here we go. They will say, where is this coming? He promised. Ever since our ancestors died, everyone goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. One more time. They will say, meaning who? The scoffers. Where is this coming, he promised? Meaning, when is the Lord coming? You keep on saying, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming, Jesus is coming back, right? So they're scoffing, they're making fun of. They will say, aren't they not saying it? Where is this coming, he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, y'all been talking about this. Everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation, meaning ain't nothing changed. Everything is continued to just be what it is. That's what the scoffers are saying. Everything is continuing to go on as nothing is happening, right? They're scoffing, they're making fun of, they're teasing. So that's pretty clear. They will say, who? The scoffers. Where is this coming, he promised, meaning the coming of the Lord? Ever since our ancestors died, everyone goes on as since the beginning of time. I mean, ain't nothing changed. Y'all keep on talking about the coming of the Lord, the coming of the Lord. Ain't nothing changed since our ancestors died. Over 2,000 years, ain't nothing happened. Y'all keep on talking about this coming of the Lord. Where is he? That's the scoffers, all right? So let's go ahead and continue to read. It says, but they deliberately forget that long ago by God's, let me get you down here. By God's word, the heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of the water and by water. Okay, let me get you back over here. But they deliberately forget that long ago by God's word. No, because we know God created everything with his word. Who is the word? Jesus. We know that God created everything by his word. Jesus is the word of God, right? Let's not forget that. Jesus spoke. Jesus is the word. It says, but they deliberately forget that long ago by God's word, the heavens came into being. The heavens came into being and the earth was formed out of the water and by water. The living word. Okay. Anyway, here we go. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. Let me see what this word means. Here we go. Let me make sure I don't have that one up that's trying to talk by itself. Give me a second. I'm just gonna act like y'all not here, okay? I'm just gonna do this study like I'm not even on here with y'all. Okay, this is the one I normally use. Thank you, Google.
Deluge.
What? Who?
Deluge.
Deluge. Okay, y'all see this word. Deluge. Okay, what does it mean? It means, inundated with a great quantity of something. So it means to be overwhelmed, overloaded, flooded, swamped, or submerged. So it just means an overwhelming or overload of something or something to overrun. So it says, by these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. So deluge means overloaded or overwhelmed or swamped and destroyed. Okay, so that's why he had to separate the waters, right? Because it was overflowing. Okay, so I'm just going to underline this word. Let me just do this because I want to know swamp overflow so I know what that means. Okay, fam, let me just highlight this up. I hope y'all still with me. I know I feel like I'm all over the place, but I'm on track. Just stay with me. Hope you're looking up your own words. Okay, let's keep going. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. That is something. Let me just bracket that off, because did y'all read this? Let's read it again slow. By the same word, okay, we're talking about the word of God. The present heavens and earth are reserved for fire. We know the world is going to end in fire this time, not water. God promised us that he would not end the world again through water. That's the covenant of the rainbow that he did with Noah. But it is to go down by fire the second time. Woo! Scripture right here. Let's go. By the same word, and you know God's word will not come back void, and he is not a liar. All right? By the same word, my Lord, the present heavens and earth are reserved, I mean they being kept for fire. Being kept for the day of judgment. Listen. And destruction. Listen to that. Of who? The ungodly. My Lord, my God, have mercy on their souls. Have mercy on their souls, Father. Please have mercy on them souls. Because I got a whole lot of family members still unsaved. Lord, have mercy. Have mercy on them. Have mercy, Lord. All right, let's go. But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. 1,000 years for us is a day to God. Do you understand? 1,000 years here on earth is like one day to God. Just think about it. That's scary, because when you think about it, 3 days, 3,000 years. Something significant about that three. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We talk about the Trinity. Jesus died, rose on the third day. 3,000 years. We always been saying 2,000 years for how long? So the third day, 3,000 years? I'm just saying, just think about it. We've been saying 2,000 years already for how long? Well, Jesus came 2,000 years ago, so we got to be in the 3,000th year now. 3 days, the number three. I don't know. Maybe I'm just thinking too much. Let's read it again. This is something that we need to do. Do not forget. That's something we should not forget. But do not forget. Crystal clear. Do not forget this, saints. This one thing. What is this one thing? Dear friends, with the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years are like a day. Just imagine eternity. One day for the Lord is 1,000 years. But like, I've been down here for 3 days. You've been down there for 3,000 years, and that's not even eternity. That's not forever. That's not infinity. 3 days for the Lord is 3,000 years. Can you imagine? Oh, no, I don't even want to think about it. No, I'm not. I don't even want to think about it. I don't even want to go for one of our days, let alone one of the Lord's days, one of the Father days, 3,000 years for one day. Oh, no. No, sir, no, ma'am. I'm good. No. Are y'all reading this? Okay, maybe it's just me. Let's read. This is our scripture right here. This is our foundational text. It says, the Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Ain't that a merciful God? Ain't that my God, I don't want to start crying, because we keep on saying, come now, Lord, come now. He's like, I'm trying to help y'all out. I'm being steadfast. right? I'm being faithful. I'm holding out my wrath, my judgment, because I need more of you guys to get it together and come to me, right? To surrender all to me. Let's read this again. This is, again, is our foundational text. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise. He's not slow in keeping his promise. Okay. As some understand slow, you may understand like, why he taking so long? It's for your benefit and your family benefit. As some understand slow, instead, he is patient. He is patient with us. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish. I know you heard this scripture before, that God doesn't want none to perish, but all to repent and have eternal life. This is the scripture. There it is. Let me highlight this. I know you've heard this before. Now you know where it's at. Now you know where it is. I know we've all heard this. God doesn't want none to perish, but for everyone to come to repentance. He wants everybody to repent. Everyone. Everyone. My Lord. Okay, let's keep going. This is good. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. And the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. My Lord, my God, that's scary. This is the coming of the Lord. Understand what I'm saying. This is the scripture right here is telling us. Oh, help me, Lord. This is, ooh. And then we got this eclipse coming up. Y'all, listen, let's read this again. But the day of the Lord will come. Let me just highlight all that. But the day of the Lord will come, what? Like a thief. You ain't gonna know when to show up. It's gonna come like a thief. The heavens will what? Disappear. The elements will be destroyed by what? Fire. And the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Y'all, he is not playing with us. Okay, let me just move on right here because we almost done with this reading. What, we at 27 minutes? We might get an hour. We might get an hour out of this. Here we go. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? That's a good question. You see that question mark? You ought to live holy and godly lives. I'm just letting that sink in. The scriptures is telling us what we need to be doing. So we can't act like we don't know. You only don't know when you don't read your word. God has given us instructions. He's telling us what we need to do. One more time. Since everything will be destroyed, he's telling us everything going to be destroyed. That's why I say heaven and earth will pass away, but only his word will stand. Get it together like yesterday, like fast and quick and in a hurry. Okay? Since everything will be destroyed in this way, what kind of people ought you to be? That's the question. What kind of people ought you to be? And then it tells us, you ought to live holy and godly lives. You ought to live holy and godly lives. Stop trying to mock the world. Meaning mimic them, imitate them, be a part of them. He says, separate yourself. Be ye separate. Be ye holy unto him to do his will, right? This is how we ought to live. The earth is going to be destroyed by fire. And he's saying in that account, everything going to come to ruins. What kind of people ought you be? We ought to live holy and godly lives, family. Everything will be destroyed. Look it. What y'all Bible say? Let's keep reading. As you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming. What? As you look forward to the day of God and speed its coming, that day will bring about the destruction of the heavens by fire, and the elements will melt in the heat. My God, this ain't no, look at this. Scripture is not, is telling us the truth. People don't want to hear this, but this is what it is. Okay, just give me a second because I'm trying to take all this in. Have I read this before? Yes, I have. But I always read the scriptures like I've never read them before. Like brand new. Like I want to read it like I've never read this before and I want to soak it all in. As you look forward to the day of God. And speed, it's coming. God's speed. Have you heard of that before? God's speed. I've heard that before. That day, come on, will bring about the destruction of the what? Heavens? By what? Fire. There we go, that repeated word. And the elements, meaning everything on this earth, will melt in the heat. Y'all, now that's really going to be hell on earth. You understand? When the earth catch fire, that's going to be hell on earth. We already in hell on earth, but I'm saying as far as the heat is concerned. He said the fire going to come from the heaven. Is y'all reading this or am I tripping? Let's read it one more time. I'm just trying to stretch the video out. Yep. As you look forward, listen, to the day of God and speed is coming. Whew. That day will bring about what? Destruction of the what? Heavens by fire. Ooh. And the elements will melt in the heat. Look at here. Okay, 13. But in keeping with his promise, we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth where righteousness dwells. Come on, he about to get rid of all this wickedness, because that's why he says separate yourselves. You are in the world, but you're not of the world. Don't get comfortable here. It's going to be destroyed one day, right? That's why he said it's only temporary. That's why you should be focusing on eternity, getting your life straight now so you can enter in by how? Having a personal relationship with him, right? It says, but in keeping with his promise, because God, when he makes a promise, he keeps it. We are looking forward to what? The new heaven and the new earth, where righteousness, where everything is going to be done God's way, because righteousness just means doing it God's way, where righteousness dwells. Come on. Come on. Help me, Lord. This is just heavy. This is a heavy word today, y'all. For me, it is. I don't know about for you, but this is a heavy word for me. I don't know how y'all feeling about it, but it's heavy. Let's keep going. So then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. Who is him? God the Father, Jesus Christ, right? God the Father and Jesus Christ. So here's some more instructions. When you read the Bible, I look for principles, I look for commands, I look for laws, I look for any type of instruction, something that I should be doing, right? So when I read, it says, so then, dear friends, since you are looking forward to this, now here's what I need to do. Make every effort. Okay, so this is something I need to be doing. I'm a believer, so I need to be making every effort to be found spotless and blameless and at peace with him. That's our job. God's not going to do that for us. We, the scripture said, need to make every effort for this to happen. We need to make every effort to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. I don't like this little H. Okay? That's just me. I like stuff to be capitalized. Okay, here we go. We need to make every effort, family, to be found spotless, blameless, and at peace with him. All right? Lord, what else does it say? Let's just keep reading. What else does it say? Bear in mind that our Lord, patience means salvation. Just as our dear brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. Okay, I was reading this. I'm sorry, I got sidetracked. One more time. Bear in mind that our Lord's patience means salvation. Just as our dear brother Paul also wrote you with the wisdom that God gave him. So God gave Paul wisdom to write to us these things. Inspired, right? Bear in mind, just listen at that. Bear in mind, mean keep in mind, keep this in the forefront of your mind. Don't forget this, remember this. Bear in mind, mean remember this, that our Lord patience means salvation. That's deep. That's deep. That's deep, 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 deep. And you can keep digging. Let me see, is this something on the other page or are we already done? Let me see real quick, y'all. Let's see. That was a short read. Are we finished? Let's see. Okay, we only got this little bit left. My Lord, this is too good. Okay, let's read. Then we're gonna get to the notes, okay? He writes the same way in all his letters, meaning Paul, speaking in them of these matters. So Paul is always talking about these matters, okay? His letters contain some things that are hard to understand. Paul's letters contain things that are hard to understand, but he talks about them still. Oops. It says, which ignorant and unstable people distort. Listen, the ignorant and unstable people distort as they do the other scriptures. Listen to this. Are y'all listening to this? To their own destruction. Whew. Wait a minute. Okay, y'all reading this. Y'all reading this word. It's crystal clear. I really know want to know what the amplified. You know that's my girl. The amplified is saying. Let me read it one more time. Got me swallowing hard and everything. Here we go. I'm trying to pay attention. You know, my back is straight. Well, really, it ain't right now, but I'm saying I'm at attention right now. Here we go. He writes the same way in all his letter. Who writes? Paul. Speaking in them these matters. The matters of what? Jesus coming back, that we need to live holy. We need to be living a godly, a blameless, and spotless life. That's what he writes in his letters, right? And it says, his letters contain some things that are hard to understand, which ignorant, unstable people distort the letters of Paul as they do the other scriptures. The scriptures is telling us that people gonna do this. That's why you got to study to show your own self-approve, right? And they do it to their own what? Destruction, family. They try to twist the scripture and make it be what they want to say, but it's going to be to their own destruction. Just do what the scriptures say do. Simple. You ain't got to add nothing. You ain't got to take nothing away. It's crystal clear. Crystal clear. Then it says, therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, listen, you hearing this right now? You have been forewarned. You can't unhear this now. All right? You cannot unhear this. You have been forewarned. Be on your guard. Put that in the comments. First comment of the day. Be on your guard. First comment of the day. That is, woo. Be on your guard. That's the first comment of the day. You have been forewarned. Be on your guard. Comment number one. Here we go. Ooh, Jesus, help me. So that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position. Listen. Jesus, listen to this. Let's read it again. Paul is saying, therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, okay, be on your guard so that you may not be carried away, so that you will not be carried away by error, people distorting the scriptures, not having an understanding of what the scriptures are saying. So you have to be on guard so that you may not be carried away by error, meaning they're not teaching you correctly, of the lawless, meaning they ain't following God's rules. They ain't his laws. They're lawlessness. That's all sin is. Sin is lawlessness. And fall from your secure position. Right now you saved, you're secure, but you start listening to doctrines of demons, people teaching you wrongly, you can be knocked off your secure position of salvation. Because now you're doing something contrary to the word of God. Just because it sounds good don't mean that it's God. One more time. Let me try to get both of these in here. Can I? Oh, maybe not. Let's just start. We're just going to read this again because I'm not making this up. Y'all reading it. Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, be on your guard. All right. I'm going slow, even for the slowies in the back, and I'm a slowie, so that you may not be carried away, okay, by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So God, this scripture is telling us right now, don't be listening to ignorant and unstable people who's going to distort the word of God, right? We got that from right here. It was clear, right? It was clear that Paul's words is hard to understand, which ignorant and unstable people distort as they do the other scriptures, right? To their own destruction. Therefore, dear friends, since you have been forewarned, meaning you are being warned that people distort the scriptures, right? People tell lies. They add to the scripture, they take away from the scripture. So that means you have been forewarned about this. So be on your guard. Study to show yourself approved, so that you may not be carried away. You better know this word. So when somebody getting up before you teaching, you'll be like, wait a minute, that don't sound right. But if you don't read, you don't know if they telling you the truth or not. That's why I don't get on here doing my own thing. We look at the book. We go by what the scriptures say. I'm not over here trying to philosophize and tell you. We read the Bible over here. The hardcore truth. Ain't no tickling of no ears. We gonna get it how he laying it out, okay? So that you may not be carried away by the error of the lawless and fall from your secure position. This is just too juicy. The scriptures is telling us, he forewarning us, you better be careful who you listening to, because they can be over there teaching error and teaching lawlessness, and that's gonna knock you smooth up out your secure position. That's scripture. I'm not making that up. You read it for yourself. But what should we be doing? It says, but grow. Hallelujah. Put that in the comments. Grow in grace. Hallelujah. Grow in the grace and knowledge. That's what we should be doing. We should be growing in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. How do you do that? By reading his word daily. Okay. How do we grow? by reading His Word daily? How do we grow in grace and in knowledge? The more we in the Word, the more we become like Christ, the more we have a mind like Christ, the more we know His will and His way, what displeases Him and what doesn't please Him. But if we just live in haphazardly doing what we want to do, we in the world, we're not following the instructions of the Bible. Listen, one more time, then we done. But grow, family. Put that in the comments. That's the what? I don't know, second or third comment of the day. Put grow in the comments. But grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him glory be to God. Be glory both now and forever. Amen. I just love the Bible. This is speaking to me. I don't know if it's speaking to y'all. I'm just highlighting all this because this is just too good. All of it. You do what you want to do. All that getting highlighted. Okay, so that, boom, concludes the reading of the Word. We have 45 minutes. I made it work. So let's go ahead and read these notes, and then we're going to get to the devotion. Okay, Lord, whoo, help me, Jesus. We're going to read these study notes. Again, this is the NIV Study Bible. And we're just going to read these notes and get a better understanding. All right, so here we go. I hope you got your pen and paper ready, okay? Because it's a lot of notes. Let's go. Second letter. It says, the first letter likely was 1 Peter through some... What? Second letter. The first letter likely was 1 Peter. Though some have suggested other options. For example, a lost... intermediate letter, because 1 Peter doesn't initially seem to be best described as a reminder to pursue wholesome thinking. Yet 1 Peter does stress the importance of thinking rightly about Christ's return, which will result in godly living. For example, 1 Peter 1:13-4-7. This provides a vivid contrast to the denial by scoffers of His return in this chapter. Okay, we read that. It says reminders, see 1:12-13, 15:3-2. Oh, this is just the next scripture we're talking about. My bad. So it says holy prophets. The prophet of the Old Testament who foretold the coming of the Messiah. Then you got these cross references here. And then it says command. See note on 2:21. Your apostle Peter places the Old Testament prophet and New Testament apostles on an equal plane. Both are vehicles of God's sacred truth. Peter, being one of the apostles, can speak with knowledge and authority as a representative of the apostolic group. All right. Now this is talking about the last days. I wish this was like bolded or something. Right? Okay, anyway. It says, an expression that refers to the whole period introduced by Christ's first coming. These days are last in comparison to the Old Testament days, which were preliminary and preparatory to the time of the Messiah. Then it's telling us to see this note here, and it says also the Christian era is the time of the beginning of prophetic fulfillment. Scoffers will come, right? He told us that. He says scoffers will come. I hope y'all can see this pretty good. Perhaps the same evil desires. Cross references. In chapter 3, however, the emphasis on Christ's return. These people may have been early Gnostic who resist the idea of a time of judgment and moral accountability, evil desires. Then they tell you to go see that note. He, which is Christ, ever since our ancestors died, likely the Old Testament patriarchs. Some have suggested ancestors refers to the first Christians to die after Christ's death and resurrection. So that's what they're talking about when it's talking about that. refers to the, where is it at? Refers to the first Christians to die after Christ's death and resurrection. And then it goes to, for example, Stephen, James, the brother of John, and the other early Christian leaders who had died. It says in Hebrews 13:7, note, okay, I'm going to skip off of that because it's going to make it sound choppy. But it says, but this is not the terminology the early church used for their foundational leaders. Everything goes on as it has. Their argument against Christ's return was, since it has not occurred up until this time, it will never occur. That's what they were meaning, right? That nature is not subject to divine intervention. They say, keyword, they say, has been proved by observation of the period since creation. Make sure this is in here. They deliberately forget, ignoring the flood. Come on, let's talk about it. They deliberately forget. God already did it one time. They deliberately forget, ignoring the flood as a divine. Get you over here. Let's get over here. Ooh, this is getting good. This is getting good. As a divine intervention was not an oversight. It was deliberate. Come on. They did not want to face up to the fallacy in their argument. God's word, okay? God said, right? Of commands such as, let there be light. Earth was formed out of water and by water. Listen. Where the waters on earth were separated from the atmospheric waters of the heavens, and the mountains then appeared, causing the earthly waters to be gathered into oceans. Ain't that awesome? By these waters also the world was deluged, meaning overflowed, we looked that word up, or overwhelmed or overtaken, and destroyed. So the water was over everything. Okay, it says, Peter points out the fallacy of the scoffer's argument. There has been a divine intervention since the time of creation, namely the flood. So Paul's trying to let him know, listen, what you talking about? He did it already before. It says, the word of God that brought the world into existence. Oh, I read that over. And that brought watery destruction on the wicked of Noah's day, will bring fiery destruction on the present world and on its wicked people. Let me read that again. By the same word that God has spoken, right? By the same word, the word of God that brought the world into existence, meaning when God spoke, and that brought watery destruction on the wicked of Noah's days, will bring fiery destruction on the present world and on its wicked people. So he did it the first time by water. He destroyed the world with the flood. The second time is going down by fire, y'all. It's going down by fire this time. It's going down by, I don't know what's better, to burn up or drown. Both of them are horrible deaths. I'ma just say that. Okay, let me not even think about it. Here we go. 1,000 years are like a day. God does not view time as humans do. He stands above time, with the result that when time is seen in the light of eternity, an age appears no longer than one short day, and a day seems no shorter than a long age. Since time is purely relative with God, he waits patiently while human beings stew with impatience. This is too good. I like these notes. I haven't been in this Bible much. Maybe twice, but I didn't even really read the notes. I was reading the word. So let's go. I'm liking it. How would y'all think? God's seeming delay is bringing about, this is our foundational text, 3 and 9, right? God's seemingly delay is bringing about the consumption of all things is a result, not of indifference. but of patience in waiting for as many as possible to come to repentance. So God's not coming now because he's being patient with us. He's giving us time to get it together. Ain't that a loving God? Ain't that a patient God? Ain't that a faithful God? Ain't that an awesome God? Thus, the scoffers are wrong on two points. They fail to recognize that all things have not continued without divine intervention. Since creation, the flood was an intervention. They misunderstood the reason for apparent divine delay. God is a long-suffering God. Whew. Delays are not denials. Come on, some, put that in the comments. Delays are not denials. That's another comment of the day, family. I like that. Delays are not denials. Woo, come on, y'all better get with it. Y'all know I don't highlight, but that was good. I gotta highlight that one. Delays are not denials. Not wanting anyone to perish. A significant statement of God's love for all people and desire for their salvation. Repentance. Okay, this is the next word we're going to talk about. It says, Day of the Lord. It goes into these notes. It says, like a thief, suddenly and unexpectedly. That's what it means. God is going to come suddenly and unexpectedly. That's why we always say, if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. Amen? Ooh, this is good. Calm down, girl. The heavens will disappear with a roar. Heaven and earth is going to pass away, y'all. How you say this? Apocalyptic language common to books like Daniel and Revelations. Due to the figurative nature of such writings, we must not expect complete literalism, but recognize it as an attempt to describe the indescribable. Listen to that. To describe the indescribable, y'all. A task as impossible as it would have been for a first century writer to describe the phenomena of our nuclear age. Okay, now it's talking about the elements. Refers either to the heavenly bodies or to the physical elements in the first century, such as earth, air, fire, and water. Okay, then it says fire. So this is just breaking stuff down one by one. Let's just keep reading. Fire. Earth laid bare. This telling us to see the notes. It says the most reliable manuscript reading suggests not that the earth will be burned as the heavens and elements will be, but that it and everything done on it will be disclosed and tested at the final judgment. Okay, so the earth ain't gonna burn up, it says. Let me read that again. I need to get some clarity. Let me just read this again. The most reliable manuscript reading suggests not that the earth will be burned, okay, as the heavens and elements will be. Ooh, that's deep. The earth ain't gonna be burned. Why? Because we're gonna have a new earth, right? Okay. As the heavens and elements will be, but that it and everything done on it will be disclosed and tested at the final judgment. Similar to the use of the same Greek term in the epistle of Barnabas. And it says, what is of value may be purified by the fires of judgment. Come on. And endure into a millennial kingdom or the eternal state. This is so deep. This is so deep, y'all. Well, at least to me. Maybe, okay, whatever, let's go. Since everything will be destroyed, at least in its current form, the transitory nature of the present form of the material universe ought to make a difference in one's system of value and one's priorities. The result should be lives of holiness, separated from sin and to God and godliness, devoted to worship and service of God. Those are some good nuggets right there. How should we live? Separated from sin. Okay? We need to be living godly lives, period. We should be devoted to worship and service of God. That should be our main focus. Not getting up, going to work, trying to get a business, trying to do this. Yeah, that can be okay, but that should not be your focus. You should not be making those things idle. Where you so busy focusing on building that business, building this, trying to have kids, doing all that, and you losing the sight of the Lord. Anything that's taking your attention away from the Lord, that's not good. I ain't got time to spend with God because you so focused on this thing over here. No, no sir, no ma'am. No sir, no ma'am. Anyway, it says the day of God, the day of the Lord. It says, since it is characterized by the same kind of events, then it says speed its coming. That day may be hesitant by God's people as they speed up the accomplishments of his purposes, since he is awaiting for all to come to repentance. That's our verse. Let me pull you down a little bit because I'll get to reading and y'all won't even be in the frame. The sooner believers bring others to the Savior, the sooner that day will draw. The sooner believers bring others to the Savior, the sooner that day will dawn. Prayer also serves to hasten the day. Destruction of the heaven. Elements will melt in heat. And you got all these notes. Y'all see it? His promise. What does it say? New heavens and a new earth are promised by Isaiah. Go read it. This promise is confirmed by Revelations. Go read it. Where righteousness dwells. Righteousness will dwell there permanently. Got some cross references there. Okay. This is what cross references is for. Help you interpret scripture with scripture, right? Which is the best way to do it. Then it says peace, which is also known as grace. Well, peace, dot, 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 grace. And it got a note to go read that. So it says spotless, blameless. We read about that. It says where the same two Greek words are applied in Christ. At peace with him. Believers have peace with God as a result of being justified by faith. Go read that. But they may displease him by failing to live as he desires and thus not receive his condemnation when he returns. Y'all read that? Okay. This exhortation is meant to be an impetus to faithful and holy living. Impetus. What is this word? Let me look this up. Impetus. I don't even know if I'm saying it right. Let me see. Baby. This got my attention. I don't know if it got y'all attention. I'm reading it kind of choppy, but I'm getting it. Hopefully y'all reading it for yourself and you getting it too, okay? Because baby, let me see how they say this.
Impetus.
I was saying impetus. Impetus.
Impetus.
Impetus. What does it mean? The force or energy with which a body moves. Momentum. Okay. Motive. Force. Okay. So it's just momentum. Just how the force of energy in which a body moves. So this exhortation is meant to be an impetus to faithful and holy living, meaning get your body in order to be faithful and holy living, right? It says our Lord patient means salvation. Ooh, okay. A note, our dear brother Paul. Peter expresses warmth in his reference to Paul. The unity of teaching and purpose that govern their relationship abundantly attested in Paul's letters and the books of Acts is confirmed here by Peter. Let's see. We almost done, I think. We almost done. Then we go into the devotion. I know. We almost done. We doing good. We had 1 hour and 4 minutes. Okay, let's read. It says writes the same way in all his letters. So just, okay, I don't like the way they do this. But anyway, it says the only place where the New Testament refers to itself, Peter may be referring in general to the exhortation to holy living in verses 11 through 14, which parallel many passages in Paul's writings. Ignorant and unstable people, likely describing the false teachers and their adherents. Mm-hmm. Other scriptures. Okay, Peter placed Paul's writings on the same level of authority as the God-breathed writings of the Old Testament. You have been forewarned that false teachers are coming. Okay, they hear, not coming, they hear. Grow in knowledge. Peter concludes by again stressing true knowledge. Put that in the comments. True knowledge. Come on, family. Write that in the comments for your girl. True knowledge. Right? Probably as an antidote to the false teachers who boasted in their esoteric knowledge. We want true knowledge. Where is that coming from? The Word of God. Hallelujah. So there it is. I don't know why I underlined that, but okay. We done with the reading of the word. Holy, holy, holy. Lord, you are so holy. Okay, family, let's go ahead and read our devotion now. We'll be done in about 10 minutes or less. Jesus, this was so good. We thank you, Lord, for being patient with us. We thank you for being long-suffering, wanting none to perish. Okay, so let's go ahead and read this through, family. It says, God has a heart for those far from him. So should we. God's love for the world and his desire to see the lost come into relationship with him compels him to be patient. Ain't that something? Jesus powerfully communicated that truth in the parable of the prodigal son. He introduced us to a younger son who did not want a relationship with his father, and in fact wished his father dead so he could receive the inheritance. When the father gave the boy his inheritance, the son left home and lived on his own terms until he hit rock bottom. However, Jesus informed us that while the young son lived out his rebellion, his father waited patiently for his return. When the son did return, the father did not lecture about mistakes or point out his errant ways. Instead, he celebrated his lost son's return. He had a party in honor of his son who was lost but now was found. Come on, fam. Like the father in this parable, God deeply loves people who are lost. He is patient. He desires them to return and repent. Lord, have mercy. When they do, he celebrates. We should treat unbelievers with the same love and patience as God, who desires to be in relationship with them. When we see them turn to the Father, may we celebrate wholeheartedly with Christ-like joy. Amen. And then we have a prayer here that we're going to read at the end. So let's go ahead and read this again with our highlights and stuff, okay? All right, fam, here we go. God has a heart for those far from him. Oh, that's deep. So should we. Amen. God's love for the world and his desire to see the lost come into relationship with him. God wants to see the lost come into relationship with him, because it's going to be the best thing they can ever do with their life, because they out there perishing, right? They perishing because they lack knowledge. They perishing spiritually because they're not really living. Because to live is to be in Christ, because he is life. Christ is life. Put that in the comments. Christ is life. Put that in the comments, family. Christ is life. So it says, God has a heart for those far from him. So should we. Very important. God love for the world and his desire to see the lost come into relationship with him compels him to be what? Patient. Because there's so many lost souls out there, God is being patient with us, because he can will anybody to turn their heart to come to him, but he want it to be on our own. He don't want to coerce us. He don't want to influence us. He just wants you to know better, to seek him with our whole hearts, for real, right? He'll tug on your heart, let you know you're doing this wrong, you're doing right, you're doing this, you don't know me. Send somebody in your life to plant that seed, and he wants you to come to him on your own, so he know that is real. And then once you come to him, best believe you're gonna get tested to see if you there for what you there for. What's your motives? Are you really here for me? Are you over there just coming because you heard about the blessing? Right? Did you come from what's in my hand, or are you coming for me? Right? That's all. That's what I want to know too. Why you want to be my friend? Why are you trying to befriend me? Okay, here we go. Jesus powerfully communicated the truth in the parable of the prodigal son. He communicated the truth of how God really feels about us too. Right? He communicated the truth. So when you look at that story, don't look at it as just the prodigal son. Look at it as that's an example of how God looks at us. That's a good perspective. It says he introduced us to a young son who did not want a relationship with his father. Come on. That's most of the world, right? They don't want to have nothing to do with God. I don't want to have nothing to do with you, man. They don't want to have nothing to do with God. They want to do their own thing, just like Adam and Eve. That's why they got kicked out. I'm not trying to obey you. We want to do our own thing. He introduced us to a young son who did not want a relationship with his father. Period. In fact, he wished his father was dead so he could receive the inheritance. He's all about the money and the blessings. He's like, I don't care about you, daddy. I want this money. I want all your land. I want all your stuff. Ain't that cold? Okay, it is what it is. It says, when the father gave the boy his inheritance, the father gave it to him. Like our father, he's still giving us stuff. He giving us a free gift. What is that? The inheritance of eternal life. And people don't even want that. They rejecting that. Okay. When the father gave the boy his inheritance, the son left home and lived on his own terms. That's what the people in the world do. They want to live on their own terms. Until what? They hit rock bottom. My Lord, my God. Until they hit rock bottom. Then they want to try to see what this Lord do. What does this Savior do? Like, Lord, I'm just here for my inheritance. I said the prayer of salvation. Now what you got for me? Ain't that cold? What you got for me? I said the prayer of salvation. I believe you died on the cross for my sins. Now, what you got? What you got for me? Quiet as it's kept, the gift of salvation is enough. If he don't do nothing else, that's enough. He ain't got to do nothing else for me. Lord, just let me in. Thank you for the free gift of salvation and being able to go into eternal heaven with you to the kingdom. That's enough for me. I don't need nothing else, Lord. I don't need nothing else. You understand? But we like, okay, yeah, we get that. Okay, but what else you got? Ain't that something? Okay, well, here we go. However, Jesus informed us that while the young son lived out his rebellion, like we do, live out our own rebellion, doing it our way, his father waited patiently for his return. While we out here living in these streets, talking about we Christians, but we still at the club, we still drinking, smoking, cussing, fornicating, but we Christian. Really? Okay. While we in our rebellion, guess what? The Father is waiting patiently for you to repent and return. Okay? You at the club on Saturday and showing up to church on Sunday. Ain't that something? Ask me how, because that was me. That was me. I'm telling you, that was me. Still in the world, wholeheartedly. But just because I thought I went to church, I thought I was saved. No. Far from it. I was still Satan kid. Period. I know that now. Lord have, I thank you, Lord, for pulling me out. I thank you, Father, for pulling me out and opening my eyes to see. Ooh-wee. Okay, here we go. When the Son did return, the Father did not lecture about mistakes. God ain't gonna throw it up in your face. He ain't gonna lecture you. You repent. He said, I am just to forgive if you just confess. Confess that you did wrong. Confess that you know better. Okay, good. Now that you did that, I'm just to forgive you. Now, don't do that no more. And let's get on the fast track. Realign yourself up underneath me. And let's do this. I forgot. Not only have I forgiven you, I forgot. So how can he bring up your mistakes if he forgot it? Right? Father did not lecture about his mistakes or point out his errant ways. He don't care. It's over. You're back in alignment now. You've been washed clean. Let's go. Ain't nothing to talk about. What we dwelling over that for? Let's get on our assignment. We got work to do. We ain't got time about talking about the woulda, shoulda, couldas. No. We got an assignment. We got souls to save. You back? Good. Now let's get to work. Let's get to work. Instead, he celebrated. Come on, family. Put that in the comments. Celebrated. Put that in the comments. Instead, he celebrated his son's return. God celebrates when we repent. God celebrates when we come back to him and surrender with our whole heart. He celebrates like, okay, you went off track. You went to the left a little bit. You went to the right. I told you to stay straight ahead, but okay, you veered off, but you're back. So let's not even worry about what you did. Now, the hard part is God forgave us. The hard part is forgiving yourself, because the enemy going to come in and try to bring that guilt, that doubt, that condemnation. And the Lord said, there's no condemnation in me. If you confess your sin, you are forgiven. Forget about it. Let's roll. Don't be over there, woe is me. What God, does God really love me? I did. He said, it's finished. That's why I died. Now get on the fast track and let's get on this. We ain't worried about what you did back yesterday. It's gone. You can't never get that back. So why are you dwelling over spilt milk? You can't put it back in the cup. Mop it up and let's go. Right? That's how Jesus, let's go. It's done. It's over. Clean up the milk and we moving on. Right? The milk is in the sponge. Now you want to drink it? I don't think so. Why are you even worried about it? It's in the sponge. It's in the towel. It's over. It's wiped up. It's clean. Let's get it. Let's go. I'm trying to worry about that spilt milk, that old sin, that stuff we used to do. We're moving forward. Forget those things that are behind, right? That's scripture. He had a party, come on, in honor of his son who was lost, but now was found. Ooh, I'm so glad. That sounds so cliche, but it's so real. I was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. That's some true statements if I ever heard them. I was lost, but now I'm found. Ooh. I was blind, Lord Jesus, but now I see. Come on. About to break out and start singing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. Ooh, don't get me started today, family. I'm loving it. All right, we almost done. I know y'all tired of me. Let's go. It says, like the Father in this parable, God deeply loves people who are lost. God deeply loves people who are lost. So he would have been told, he would have been burnt us up if that was the case. All this wickedness that's going on in this world, I think it's triple Sodom and Gomorrah back then. You understand what I'm saying? Ain't nothing new under the sun. They was doing what we doing now back then too. He is patient. Put that in the comments. I know we got a lot of comments today. Okay, because these are some good ones. He is patient, family. I thank you, Lord, for your patience. I thank you for your mercy. Woo, that's just too good. He is patient. He desires them to return and repent. Return and repent. That's what he requires. I mean, that's what he desires. And he require it too. He requires it. I said it right the first time. He desires and requires, bars, for you to repent and return, or return and repent. Whew. When they do, guess what? He celebrates. I think we already got that one. He celebrates. He celebrates. Not just him, the whole kingdom of heaven, the angels too. Every time somebody gets saved, they come from the darkness into the light, they having a party. If you read the Old Testament, they was partying. It was a feast. They was having feast days all over the place. God likes to party, y'all. If you didn't know, you better go read the Old Testament and see all them feast days and stuff we should be celebrating now. So many feast days. Passover is coming up. I hope you're celebrating Passover and not Easter. I'm just saying. I hope you're celebrating Passover and not Easter. I'm just saying. Do your own research. Anyway, it says, we should treat unbelievers with the same love and patience as the God who desires to be in relationship with him. Come on. Whew. When we see them turn to the Father, may we do what? Celebrate wholeheartedly with Christ-like joy. My Lord, my God. My Lord, my God. Oof. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I didn't say Happy Easter on purpose, right? Because I don't celebrate Easter no more. I used to because I was ignorant. But I don't celebrate Easter. I celebrate Passover. So it ain't on purpose that I didn't say Happy Easter. I don't celebrate Easter. I celebrate the Passover. Okay? And if you celebrate Easter, God bless you. I don't. You do your own homework on that one. Okay, here we go. It says, when you see them turn to the Father, may we celebrate wholeheartedly with Christ-like joy. My Lord, my God. That's it, fam. Let's read this prayer and we are out of here. We are out of here. It says, Father God, your patience, your love, your forgiveness, your rejoicing, your celebration, your grace, like the Father's for his son who returned home, truly are amazing. Amen to that. Amen to that. Woo. My Lord, my God. God is faithful. Whew. I thank you for your resurrection, Father God. I thank you for your resurrection. All right, family, we are done. We are 1 hour and 22 minutes. So I did all right. We did all right. But anyway, family, I love you guys so much. Continue to pray for me as I pray for you. Y'all get your study on, okay? Go study. Especially if you are not understanding the difference between Easter and Passover. Look it up. Google it. All right. Do your homework. Okay. That's all I'm gonna say about that. I don't want to be debating in the comments. Just do your own homework on that one. All right. I love you guys so much. I pray for you guys all the time. So I wish and hope that you continue to pray for me. I am, let me see. Yeah, that's it. That's all I really got. I love you guys. Pray for me as I pray for you. And I'll see you all next week if God spares lights. Talk to you soon. Shalom.